Second reading from the book of Hebrews of the 10th chapter. Every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us. For after saying, "This is a covenant that I will make with them after those days," says the Lord, "I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened up for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed clean with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The smartest one that I've ever had. recently, she started a new game that she plays pretty much with herself, but it's fascinating. One day, as we were coming down the hill toward our driveway, she spotted a tennis ball that was lying up near the side of the road. She went over to it and sniffed it, kept on going. The next day, for whatever reason, that same tennis ball, I think, was closer down the hill toward our driveway. This time, she sniffed it, she picked it up, and she carried it with her almost to the entrance of our driveway, where there are a couple of trees and a big rock. She went over to the trees, dug a little hole, not very deep, dropped the ball in, and then covered it over by pushing with her nose. And then she tapped down with her nose. The next day, as we're coming by, she pulled me over to exactly where it was, uncovered it, picked it up, took it inside our yard to a different spot, dug a little hole, put it in, covered it over, tamped it down. The next day, we came back from our first walk of the day, and she went right over to it, dug it up, picked it up, took it further into our yard, found yet another spot. This went on for several days, until one day, she didn't seem to want to pay attention to it. And another day went by, and a third day went by. And on the fourth day, she must have decided that it was time, because coming back from the walk, she pulled me over to where it was, exactly where it was. I wasn't quite sure at that point. She went right to where it was, dug it up, found yet another spot, and buried it. Some animals have incredible memories. There's also the story of an elephant who had been chained to a post with not a very long chain. And, you know, the elephant had the chain around one leg and a post in the ground. And for probably several years, that elephant was confined to that small space, walking around and around and around. And then one day, somebody came and purchased the elephant. They were going to stay there, but they decided that this had been cruel to the elephant, and so they took the chain off the elephant's leg. That elephant continued to stay within that circle and did not leave the circle. It had become so used to, perhaps, that boundary, and it didn't forget, and it wouldn't leave. Animals are amazing creatures. I heard just this morning the story of the wolf dogs between here and Asheville. I guess they're near Black Mountain somewhere. Well, these are dogs, wolf dogs, bred between wolves and dogs and their descendants. And if they make friends with you, they are very loyal. Unless you do something that startles them, upsets them, is out of character for you, and the wolf dog then sort of breaks the relationship, and it doesn't seem as though it can be repaired. So that wolf dog that had been your friend just puts up a wall and says, "Nope, I'm done." I think sometimes we as people have a hard time forgetting. You know, people say, say forgive and forget? I think sometimes we're okay with the forgive part, but most of the time I think we struggle with the forget part. I thought of that especially today as I was studying the second lesson. This is talking about our sin and how Jesus paid the price for our sin and what is our inheritance now. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. And this is a quote from the Old Testament. I will put my laws in their hearts and will write them on their minds. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Once you and I receive God's forgiveness, God literally forgets about what our sin was. God forgets completely. The slate is washed completely clean. And whatever it was that we have done, God forgets. And God forgives us completely. Now, all of our lessons today sort of point us toward the end times. Jesus, speaking with his disciples, first of all, is talking about the destruction of the temple, which occurred in 70 AD. And it has never been rebuilt. But he also talks about, with the disciples who are saying, well, when's this going to happen? He's talking to them about more than just the destruction of the temple. He's talking about more the end times. And he says, when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, there will be earthquakes, all of this is going to happen. That's just the birth pangs. Just the birth pangs. Really? For Jesus to use such an allusion must mean something. Now, I have never given birth. Several of you out there, many of you have. And so I suspect you will be able to attest to this much better than I. I understand that it's quite a painful process. But one of the things that seems to get women through this process is the promise and the expectation of the new life that is being birthed. And the joy and the expectation of that joy helps the time pass and helps the mother through. Jesus is saying about the end time that all of the things that will happen, that's just the painful process that the world and you and I have to go through in order for that joy, that indescribable joy that will come after that time. The time when you and I will be welcomed home. The time when you and I will be greeted by God who will say, I love you, I forgive you, and I don't remember any of that stuff, because I forgive you completely. Come and enter the banquet prepared for you. But what about today? What about today? Because Christians have been waiting for that end time for over 2,000 years, and it hasn't happened yet. And it may or may not happen in our lifetime. as Christian people, we are called to remember and to expect that one day all of this will be no more. All of the buildings, all of our homes, all of the things that we depend upon will one day be no more. And if we have only depended upon our bank accounts, our retirement funds, our house, whatever it is, if we have only depended on those things, then we will be destroyed also. But if our trust and our hope is in God, if our trust and hope and expectation is in God, then that makes a huge difference. And it has ramifications for here and now. Going back to that second lesson, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another. Provoke to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. So we are encouraged not to give up on that hope, but to hold it fast, to hold it confidently, and to continue meeting together, because as we do so, we encourage each other. And it says to provoke. I think that's a strange word there, to provoke one another to acts of mercy, of good deeds, of love. I prefer encourage. Encourage one another. And I think that one of the things that we can try to practice as best we can is that forgiveness and forgetfulness. To try to forgive as God has forgiven us. God has forgiven us in such a way that God remembers our sin no more. Maybe we can try and do that with each other and with others in our lives. Forgiving, not holding grudges, and also completely forgetting what the offense was. I know it's not easy, because I know that for me personally, if somebody has hurt me, I may indeed forgive them, but then there's always that little wariness that I have that says, they hurt me once, how will he or she do it again? The lessons today are inviting us to give up that wariness, to give up the remembrance of the offense, and to forgive completely as you and I have been forgiven by God. It's not easy, but then being a Christian isn't. Amen. I invite you to turn to hymn number 438, My Lord, What a Morning. Stand and sing as you are able.
Thank you.
provide shelter for the homeless and food for the hungry. We pray especially for John, Betty, Merle, Fay, Wayne, Shirley, Mickey, Renee, Chuck, Jill, Willow, BJ, Shayla, Lorena, Joanne, Thelma, Paul and Linda, Vivian, David, Regina, Caitlin, Ivy, Bob, Howard, Debbie, Fabra, Bud, Kelly, Pete, Stella, Andy, Gail, Aaron, April, Lori, and Catherine. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You bless us in our coming and our going, in our waking and our sleeping, and in our daily work. Make our love and good deeds a reflection of the freedom you give us in Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You grant us everlasting life through the witness of your saints, especially Cody Harrelson, who now rests in the Lord. Inspire us in our lives in faithful service. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers, spoken and silent, that we commend to you this day, trusting in your abundant mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a greeting of God's peace with one another without shaking hands.
Pete?
So,
I haven't done it yet.
Of course.
Rained all week.
Excuses.
Oh, you heard it with her.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
We do.
Happy birthday.
to pray. Creator God, you made everything, and you provide for every need. The bread we break and the wine we pour come from you.
As we eat and drink with thanksgiving, fill us with your love, and let that love flow through us to others, and join us to the saints before us in a holy and balanced communion. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Remembering, therefore, his acts of healing, his body given up, and his victory over death,
we await the day when all the peoples of the earth will come to the river to enjoy the tree of life.
Send your spirit upon us and this meal.
As grains scattered on the hillside have become like bread, so let your church gather from the ends of the earth, that all may be fed with the bread of life.
Through him all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and hear us as we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. We come to the Lord's table not because we deserve to, but because we are loved and completely forgiven. Hunger no more, thirst no more. Come to the banquet of life.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. and keep us in his grace.
Amen.